everybody. I'm live this afternoon here to answer your questions. Whatever you want to ask me, I'm here and ready to listen and learn and talk to you about any questions that you might have. So jump on, join us, say hello in the chat box. I'm going to get my screen up so that I can see your questions as we go here. And like I said, I'm here live for your question and answers. Anything you want to ask me, I'll be here for 35 to 40 minutes and looking forward to connecting with you. And like I said, I just want to get my screen up here. While I'm doing that, if you haven't been to jillcarnahan.com, we've got lots and lots of articles there for free on all different topics of interest. And you can also visit drjillhealth.com for other products, services, things that I like to share there. And like I said, we are live for your Q&A. Stop in, tell me where you're from, say hello in the chat box. And I'm just getting my boxes, my views of both screens up here so that I can listen. I see there's a comment. Hi, Jenna. I will be right with you with your question. I want to get this so that I can see all of your questions and comments here live. So just bear with me for a moment. Say hello. Tell me where you're from. And we will get to your questions in just a moment. Okay. So Jenna, I didn't get all your question. If you want to try that again. And do you have any thoughts on how to, and that's the end of it there. But if you just put in your question again, I would love to answer. Hi, Marianne from Florida. Stop in, tell me where you're from. If you're listening live here, I am here this afternoon on Good Friday and here to answer your questions there. Jenna, so do you have any thoughts on how to tackle lingering COVID infection in the gut? New studies show the connection between long COVID and lingering virus hiding in the gut. Suffering from long COVID, and it looks like there's more, but I can start there and you can continue typing in. Like I said, everybody, we're live. I'm here to answer your questions. So tell me where you're from, say hello and type in your questions and I can should be able to see you from where I'm watching here and just answer these questions live. So long COVID, this is a complex. It's really no different. In functional medicine, we've been dealing with chronic illness for a long time. We've been dealing with reactivation of viruses like Epstein-Barr and CMV. And even like chronic Lyme disease, Borrelia, Babesia, Bartonella, Ehrlichia, et cetera, Rocky Mountain spotted fever, mycoplasma. I've been dealing with infections like this in patients for many, many years. So there's not a lot new, except that COVID has affected a huge part of the population, and it definitely increases the cytokine storm. And so often post-virus, people will have sequelae, which we're now calling long COVID, either brain fog or fatigue or autoimmunity or inflammation. And it's going to be a big thing. I think we are just at the verge of a tsunami in healthcare, as far as the increase in autoimmunity and things that we are going to see since this pandemic. So your question on long COVID and what we can do. So this is complex. I'm starting to do some panels that look at different cytokines because what I want to know is which pathways are inflamed and then how to mitigate each different pathway may have different answers. But in general, I can tell you that some of the most important things that would work for most everyone would be an anti-inflammatory diet, very low sugar, low carb, if possible, healthy fats, healthy proteins, and really watching the refined processed sugars. Clean air, making sure you have air filtration in your house or your office or wherever you are so that you're breathing non-toxic air. Things like wildfire smoke and toxic chemicals in our environment absolutely have an effect on our predisposition towards inflammation. We saw that with the wildfires that happened December 30th in my community, burned down about 1,000 houses. And we're still recovering from that. But and a lot of you, if you're local, you might have been some of those who've even lost your homes. And I'm so sorry because it was just traumatic for all of us. All that to say, though, the wildfire smoke, which is getting worse every year, the amount of wildfires really does affect our immune system. I feel like it's probably as an inflammatory of an attack on our system as mold illness and mold-related exposure. So having said that, clean air. Clean water, making sure you're drinking clean water. So anti-inflammatory diet, clean air, clean water, movement is good. But a lot of post-COVID patients will have exercise intolerance. And it's actually important not to overrun your system and push too hard because part of the issue can be either thicker blood or hypercoagulation or difficulty with oxygenating the tissues. So some of the basic things that are really important are fish oil, if you tolerate that, SPMs can be really really powerful. One of the ones I recommend that you can find on drjillhealth.com is SPM Active. That's a real great anti-inflammatory. There's another product I have called Cytoblox, C-Y-T-O-B-L-O-X, on drjillhealth.com. This is a combination of Chinese skullcap and turmeric and a few anti-inflammatory herbs that tend to really calm down the system. Like I said, clean air, clean water, clean food. I can't say that enough. Gut, I think you specifically ask about gut issues. That's real common as well because there's many ACE receptors in the gut and very important to take care of the gut post-COVID and if you have COVID long haul symptoms. Some of the things I recommend for the gut would be bovine immunoglobulins. There's a product called Gut Immune Powder at drjillhealth.com that you can use as a scoop or two per day, and that will actually bind passively both the virus and other pathogens. So it's a great kind of immune support on the gut level of immunoglobulins that you can take as a powder. And then I love spore probiotics. And we have one called Spore Probiotic with IG that's been really powerful and helpful post-COVID. Those two things, the gut immune powder and the spore probiotic with IG, are really powerful in supporting that gut. And then, like I said, clean diet is really, really important. Exercise moderation. You want to kind of do what you can do without getting excessive fatigue. It might be just a walk a couple blocks and then slowly titrate up. Some people have coagulation issues post-COVID. And if that's the case with you, you could, again, with your doctor's direction, I'm not giving you medical advice. You may need to take a baby aspirin, or you may need to be on something that's anticoagulant like fish oil or garlic or Belouk, which is a systemic enzyme. You can find that funny name, B-O-U-L-O-U-K-E, at drjillhealth.com, or something like pycnogenol or natokinase. These are all long, funny names, but they tend to either vasodilate the system or chew up that little fibrin that can be produced with inflammation. And both of those things can help with blood flow to the brain, to the circulatory system and the periphery, so that you don't have as much symptoms. Like I said, this is quite a complex disease. And what I'm doing with patients is looking at all the different cytokine pathways and then identifying where the deficits lie and then targeting specific drugs or supplements for those pathways. But in general, those are hopefully a few helpful things. Like I said, say hello. If you missed my intro, say hello, tell me where you're from, throw your questions here. I am live and I'm going to get through as many questions as I can. Jenna, hopefully that answered at least some of your questions on long COVID. Hi, Kimberly from Virginia. Hi, Peggy. Thank you for your kindness and for thanking me. I love being here with you. And that is means a lot. Jenny, you just continued. Love to know how to tackle this long COVID. And so the gut, you're asking specifically about the gut. The gut, I would say spore probiotics. My favorite is spore probiotic with IG and or the gut immune powder. Those two things can be really helpful. And then an anti-inflammatory diet, low sugar, all those things are really key. Now, one thing we're seeing post-COVID is CD8, part of the immune system. You don't need to know what that is, except that it fights viruses and cancer, can be a little bit in a weakened state. So I am seeing more and more patients that have reactivation of Epstein-Barr or shingles or other viruses. So one of the things you may want to differentiate is this just long COVID sequelae of that virus and infection itself? Or is it actually a new virus or old virus more likely that you had that's being reactivated? So Epstein-Barr can present in a lot of different ways, but one of the ways that I see it in clinical practice is chronic fatigue, malaise, feeling the lymph nodes in the neck swelling off and on, feeling flu-y or almost like a low-grade temperature off and on. That's kind of a viral kind of syndrome. And that would be very common with Epstein-Barr reactivation, and especially the fatigue, sometimes intermittent sore throat that just comes and goes and never turns into anything. If those are the things you're experiencing, some of my favorite things for that would be olive leaf, monolaurin, L-lysine, and sometimes even prescription antivirals. Shingles is really common as well. I've seen a lot of young people with shingles due to post-COVID, because that weakens that arm that kind of suppresses the viruses like chickenpox or varicella. So that's another thing you can do, is to support the immune system. A lot of this has to do with the immune system and different arms of the immune system becoming weakened so that other things can pop up. And I've even seen patients with chronic Lyme that are stable that tend to flare up after they get the infection. So hopefully, Jenna, that helps you. Let me know if you have more questions. Just keep typing them in. I'm just going to keep going down. Mary Ann, hello. How much emphasis do you place on the low mold diet? Well, Mary Ann, great question, because you know I'm one of the mold experts, and I love to talk about that. What I would say with the low mold diet is it's really critical if you are in a moldy environment or if you're recovering from mold related illness, because in those states that mold has weakened your immune system. And if you eat a lot of sugar or carbs, you're feeding either the candida or fungus that's in your system. Or if you, some people actually have mold colonization in the sinuses, in the gut, in the body, in the lungs. And either of those things, the sugar in the diet will really, really make that hard to get rid of. So if you really are in a moldy situation, you're overcoming mold-related illness, I highly recommend the low mold diet. If you just stopping in, please say hello, throw your questions here. I'm going to stay here as long as I can to answer all of them that I can get through. And I'll be sure and put some links here. So you can always check back, save this link, and I'll try to put links in for products, for the low mold guide. You can always check on jillcarnahan.com and search low mold diet, and it's all on there for free on the website too. So thanks for asking that, Marianne. If you have another question, just type it right in. Melina, hi from Wisconsin. Hello, I grew up in Illinois, so not too far from Wisconsin, and I know that state very well. Alexis, if you have Lyme, BART, and mold, and then treat mold and feel better, do you need to treat the infections? What a great question. So I talk about this all the time. I feel like if we were to go testing people on the street, walking along, feeling fine, no major complaints for Lyme disease, we would probably find a lot of people had Lyme, had been infected maybe as a child, or a tick bite or a spider bite with Bartonella or a cat scratch, or one of those things that can carry the vectors of these kinds of tick-borne illnesses, and they're fine. And the reason for that is their immune system is strong and robust and healthy and actually keeping those infections at bay. That's what we're supposed to do. But the problem lies when that immune system gets weak, and then these old infections, kind of like I was just talking with long COVID and viruses, they pop back up and start to cause symptoms and problems. So that's not uncommon. And that's when people actually complain of chronic Lyme. So back to your question, you have Bartonella, you have Lyme, you have mold, you've been treating the mold, your immune system's probably getting back online. And there are a large number of people that don't really need to be aggressively treating those infections if they feel better after they get through the mold treatment. The reason for that is the mold really suppresses the immune system. There's one mycotoxin produced by many different molds called mycophenolic acid. That mycotoxin is actually used as a drug called Cellcept that's given to people after organ transplants, which means it suppresses their immune system so it doesn't reject the organ. That shows you how strong of an immune suppressant it is. And that means that if you have other infections, which we all do, many of us have had chickenpox or Epstein-Barr or other things, they can reactivate or become more active in a weakened state, which is often the case when you're in a mold or water damaged building. So, bottom line, Alexis, is if you feel better after the treatment with the mold, it's unlikely that you need a lot of aggressive further treatment for those infections. And that's a bonus, because not everybody gets to say that, but that is a wonderful thing. Diego, hello. With your advice, and my naturopathic doctor got better to the point I feel 90% better. Oh, I love that. That makes me so happy. You know, there's nothing that I get more joy from if the information that I write or put out there or do on my podcast helps you, and you don't even have to see me, or you work with another doctor. I get so excited about that, because it's hard, obviously, to see everybody who has needs, and there's probably not enough doctors to go around. But I love the fact that you're sharing that you are getting better. But your question is, naturopathic doctor wants to take a Genova GIFX stool and an oat organic acid to ensure there's nothing left in my system. However, the preparation says the patient should not take any prebiotics, probiotics, betaine, and you feel really good on those things. So you're wondering, this is a great question. So you're asking real specifically about repeating a stool test, and the instructions say go off all the things that are making you feel better, right? So there's this conundrum there, because a lot of people feel really, really good when they take their supplements, they take their digestive enzymes. I do, if I'm doing the test with my patients, I do it one of two ways. Obviously, if you follow the instructions, you go off those things, you get a better picture of your baseline. But if someone's feeling really poorly when they go off of their supplements, I will often test with them on the supplements up to just a day or two prior. And I'll just take into account when I'm looking at the test results that they were on their HCL and their enzymes. And we know that pancreatic elastase, which is a stool enzyme that, that basically tells us if our pancreas is working or not, it is it will show up in the stool high or low, regardless of if you're taking digestive enzymes. So that won't interfere at all with the test. Betaine HCL may change the amount of protein that's in your stool. So you might not see, if you take HCL and you're breaking down the protein, you may not see the high protein in the stool that you would see if you went off the HCL. But again, as a good doctor, I'm sure your naturopath could interpret if you really feel like you need to stay on those things. I often tell patients to go and stay on. I will interpret it and just know that you were on either herbs or whatever. So talk to your naturopathic doctor about that. But I would say that there's ways to review it and keep you on those things that are helping you feel better. Or instead of stopping for 2 weeks, you can stop for just a few days. So hopefully that helps, Diego. And thank you for your kind words of that you're feeling better. Coach Brenner, looking for insight on aromatase inhibitors and good alternatives to reduce estrogen. It's Judy Ann, it looks like. Hi, Judy Ann from Minnesota. So what a great question. Aromatase inhibitors. So let's talk a little bit about aromatase and what happens. So when we take testosterone and convert it to estrogen, which both men and women do, that's called aromatase. There's an enzyme that actually pulls the testosterone, makes estrogen out of it. We all do that, women more than men, because we have more estrogens. But often when you're in a moldy environment or you're in a toxic environment, you can have that aromatase upregulated. So men will all of a sudden have lower testosterone, lower libido, increased body fat, central weight gain, more sluggish, more melancholy or more emotional, all kinds of symptoms from too much estrogen in men. And it's not a good thing for men to have too much estrogen. For women, it might cause endometriosis, fibroids, fibrocystic breast, tenderness, heavy periods, painful periods, PMS, all of that stuff can be from excess estrogen. So you're asking about options for aromatase inhibitors. One thing we frequently use is anastizole, which is also called Arimidex. It's a breast cancer drug because it blocks aromatase, but we use that in both men and women. When men are taking testosterone, I'll often put them on an aromatase inhibitor so that they keep their testosterone as testosterone and they don't convert it to too much estrogen. And I'll check in the blood work and make sure that their level of estradiol in the blood is less than 50 for men. For women, you can do the same thing, but often you take it a little bit longer than that. And if I'm looking, I know I'm here on Zoom, but it looks like I might be off the live video. I'm just going to keep talking and hopefully this will come back on. And so basically for aromatase inhibitors naturally, saw palmetto is a great option. Usually 320 up to 640 milligrams per day can be useful. Pygium and pumpkin seeds are also good aromatase inhibitors, and those can be helpful as well. So like I said, I don't know if my video is still on Facebook. If you guys can see me, say hello. And if not, I'm going to keep going because I am, see here. I am seeing at least my video here. We'll see what happens. Okay, so thank you, Kristen. Always so informative. Hello from Portugal. Hi, Anna. Taylor, hello. And what shower filter do you recommend? I recommend... Clearly filters is my favorite, but I believe that they, good. Thank you guys for letting me know you can see me. I can't see it here, but as long as it's still going, I'm here and answering questions and I can see your feed. So you can comment, you can say hello, you can throw in your questions. I'll try to keep getting to them. Please just keep throwing in those questions and I'll keep going. So let's see, we've got, let me see where I was here on questions. Taylor, you with your shower filters. So shower filters, Clearly Filtered used to make a great shower filter. I think they stopped production for a little while, but they still make great filters like for the house and the fridge and all of that water bottle filters. I'm going to share real quick. There's a lot of things I've already mentioned that I'll come back and share. I don't want to take the time now, but my products we love page has a ton of great resources because it's all the things that I like to use myself. And I'm going to share that link in the chat so you guys can browse through those things. It's everything from PMF mats to shower filters, to water filters, to air filters. So you'll see that link come up here shortly in the feed. And that gives you some ideas. Okay. Let's see. Where are we here? Okay, we talked about sharp. Hi, Peggy. Multiple HLA genes and their factor in mold detoxing. Okay, so Peggy's asking about some of the genetics with mold. Now, we do know that there's about a quarter of people that are more susceptible to mold-related illness. And what that means is their innate immune system has more trouble tagging and clearing toxins. So instead of the toxins like being tagged and escorted out of the body, they recycle around and around and around, and they start to cause collateral damage in these inflammatory pathways. And that's about one in four people have that genetics. Now, Dr. Shoemaker did some research and said specific HLA types were a higher risk. He even called them the dreaded genes. As we looked at that research deeper, it's not as valid as we thought it was. So while we still clearly know that there are types that have more trouble clearing, I would not go to say there's a striation of super high risk people who absolutely can't clear toxins, because people of all different genetics can get well. And that's the good news for you. The genetics matter, but they matter less than we used to think. So thank you, Peggy, for your question. Hi, Anne. Best diet for SIBO. So my favorite diet for SIBO is the SCD specific carbohydrate diet combined with the FODMAP diet. And if you want to download the copy that I use, it's at Allison Seebecker's website called SIBOinfo.com. SIBOinfo.com, you can get the SIBO SCD combined diet. It's a really effective diet, not only for Crohn's or colitis or inflammatory bowel disease, but also for SIBO. But the bottom line for SIBO is a low FODMAP diet is the best. Now, there's some caveats, because if you go on a low FODMAP diet, you feel better, but then you reintroduce the FODMAP foods, you feel worse. I don't love for people to be on a low FODMAP diet indefinitely, because what you're doing is you're starving the bacteria, those guys that are overgrown, but you're also starving the good guys. So what I like to do is get people treated with either herbs or medications, put them on a low FODMAP diet for up to 6 months, and then try to add those foods back in, because you want to feed the good guys. Hi, Linda. Since COVID, having arrhythmia is looking for direction. This is sadly very, very common. It has to do with blood thickness. It has to do with hypercoagulation. It has to do with the heart itself and inflammation. So there's not a one size easy answer here. And I'm sorry, I can't give you like a just one thing. But what I would say, I mentioned earlier, you can re-listen to this, things that are natural anticoagulants like garlic, fish oil can be helpful. One of my favorites, pycnogenol, is a natural vasodilator. I'm going to try to put the link in for that, because that's such a big favorite of mine, pycnogenol. You can find that at drjillhealth.com. P, if I'd spell it right, I'm going to just put, thanks for your patience here. I'm going to try to pull that up so that I can share it with you guys. I'll put these links in later too, but pycnogenol and then Beluk, natokinase, serrapeptase are all things that chew up fibrin. So if you have an increased risk of clotting, and even though this is complex, you need to find a doctor who could actually do your coagulation panels, but you can test these things all in the blood in regular labs, things like antithrombin, fibrin, protein C, protein S, MTHFR, et cetera. There's a whole list. If you haven't seen my What's the Fuss About Fibrin? It's a podcast I did with Dr. Ann Corson. I don't know the number, but if you go to my YouTube channel and just look up Ann Corson under Dr. Jill Live, you can watch that. And I list all the different things Ann talks about, the panels that she does. So if you want to learn more about that, Linda, that might be helpful. For now, I would work on stabilizing the heart with nutrients like taurine and CoQ10 and magnesium. And then I would think about the blood thickness if there's issues there, and maybe try some fish oil or garlic. And again, under the direction of your own physician. Hi, Jeanette. Doing 2 times a year cleanses for 15 years, 5 ozone treatments and a sweat pod. Oh my goodness, you're doing amazing things. My body sweat was itchy and dark brown. And the worst what happened on your face, like third degree burns. What the heck is going on? Okay, so you did some amazing things that were detoxifying your system, but what's very, very common is that we go too fast. So here's a really simple concept that's very important to understand when you're working on detox or working with your doctor. We are mobilizing toxins, which means we're taking them out of the tissues, getting them into the bloodstream, getting them prepared to be eliminated through the stool, through the urine, through the sweat, through the lungs, through the breath, right? So mobilization is one part of this. Excretion is the other. That's your pathways like lymphatics or sweat or stool or urine or breath, all the ways that we eliminate toxins from the body. But if you can think about this as a seesaw or something that needs to be in balance, if you mobilize too quickly, so you do sauna every day, 45 minutes at 140 degrees for 7 days a week, you're probably going to mobilize more quickly than you can excrete. And when that happens, you get toxic, you feel sick, you get rashes, you don't do well. Sometimes people get mast cell activation. So this is a real important concept, because if you're mobilizing too quickly for excretion, you need to slow down the mobilization. Some people can only tolerate, you know, 10 minutes in a sauna at 100 or 110 degrees. And I always go slowly enough so that people can mobilize in the same rate they're excreting. Because if we go too quickly, you can either activate your mast cells or get rashes or get side effects, or the sweat that you're talking about sounds like it was kind of toxins coming out of your body. But if you can't get rid of it quick enough, you're mobilizing too quickly. Things that mobilize could be glutathione, NAC, sauna, all these good things. But if you go too quick and you can't excrete it, you get sick and you don't feel well. So real important lesson for all of us to learn. I remember way back when I got mold exposure, I took tons of charcoal, loads of charcoal. I got rashes, hives from head to toe for like 2 months. And I learned my lesson the hard way that I was mobilizing too quickly. So thank you for sharing that, Jeanette. And I would just slow down, work with your doctor on how fast you can detox and work on excretion. Ways that you can work on excretion would be dry brushing, hot, cold saunas, or hot and cold therapy, like hydrotherapy, Epsom salt baths. You could do castor oil packs, or you could do coffee enemas, which may sound crazy, but we have imported some amazing, easy to use coffee enema kits from Switzerland. Be sure and check that out, because that's a really easy way to enhance detoxification. Most people feel really, really good when they do that. So those are just a few things. Okay, where are we here? Let's see, we talked about the sweat and the detox. Sean, hi Sean, thanks for discussing EBV reactivation, very important. How do you accurately diagnose? Okay, this is easy. So you wanna ask your doctor for 4 labs. They're Epstein-Barr titers. You want VCA, IgG, you want early antigen, you want nuclear antigen, and you want IgM. IgM is the acute reactant that would be there if you first had Epstein-Barr. Most people are going to be negative because they had it years ago when they were 12 or 19 or 25. The other 3, VCA, IgG, early antigen, and nuclear antigen, if all 3 of those are positive, especially the early antigen, it is likely that you have reactivation. So I would say if you have history and symptoms that are consistent with reactivation, and then you have all of those labs positive on titers, especially high levels like 4 times the normal, then it's very likely you have reactivation of Epstein-Barr. And like I said earlier, you can treat that with olive leaf, monolaurin, L-lysine. In fact, there's a product that I love, and I'm going to try to find that for you right now. It's called humic monolaurin complex. And I am finding it right now, so I can stick this in the chat. This would be a great thing that would help if you have reactivation of Epstein-Barr, humic monolaurin complex. I just threw that right in the chat for you guys. Okay, so where are we? Arrhythmias, we talked about detox, we talked about Epstein-Barr reactivation. Thank you, Diego, for your kind words. Alexis, so fun. It really is. I love this. You started LDN, been a game changer. Okay, LDN, low-dose naltrexone. So low-dose naltrexone is a very low dose of an anti-opioid drug that was used years ago for heroin addicts. Sounds crazy, doesn't it? But what it does at very low doses is it pokes the immune system, blocks opioid production just for a short period of time, and your body's very smart. And so it increases natural endorphins and opioids. So usually people feel better, they have less pain, less inflammation, and it decreases cytokines. So not everybody responds, but those who do, it's really good for autoimmunity and inflammation. And it's also a way for people who post-COVID to prevent those autoimmune reactions that can lead to long COVID. So I think it's a game changer. You're asking, Alexis, do you go backwards if you go off? I have not found that to be the case, but it also is something people typically stay on fairly long-term. Thanks for letting me know I'm still here. Hi, Marcy. Hi, Eileen. Hi, Judy Ellen. And your question is letrozole, which is that one's an aromatase inhibitor as well, after lumpectomy and radiation, stage 1 breast cancer. You know, that's best left to your doctor. I don't want to comment or tell them differently, but aromatase inhibitors are a really good way. I'm a breast cancer survivor as well. 20 years, I think most of you know that, but if you didn't, I 25 years old, had aggressive breast cancer. So I know a lot about hormones and aromatase inhibitors. I would recommend you're on that. It probably is a good idea and more safe to prevent recurrence. Thanks for the heart, Eileen. Okay. A few more questions and then we will sign off. I see a few more coming in. Kimberly, mono for over 20 years, still testing high on antibodies, but IgM negative. Yeah, so what happens is that IgM will only go positive the first time you have Epstein-Barr. It will never, ever, ever go positive again. So even now, if you get reactivation of Epstein-Barr, that IgM will go positive and then go negative, and it won't ever go positive again. So unless you have that first case of Epstein-Barr, you're not going to see that. What you are going to see is the VCA IgG, the early antigen and the nuclear antigen, and they're all going to be pretty high. And that's how you know, along with symptoms. So that's the answer to your question, Kimberly. You could have a doctor test those tests and see if you're high. Sometimes people are just, you know, treat, like I put on this chat, the humic monolaurin complex. That's a great thing to take that could be helpful as well. Hi, Marcy. What might be going on if mycotoxin test comes back with no mold? Off the top of my head, ooh, I have some ideas on this. So my first experience probably 10 years ago with mycotoxin testing, that's urinary testing to look at excretion of mycotoxins in my patients. And I had two patients that I was sure had moldy homes. I was just positive. And both of them tested completely negative. And I was so confused. I thought, what in the world? I know they have mold, but they're testing negative. What I learned was some people, we talked about mobilization and excretion. That's a toxin kind of pathway of how we get things out of our body. Some people are so toxic that their pathways are completely blocked. So if you don't pre-treat them with sauna or glutathione, or they're just so sick, they may not secrete any toxins in the urine. And that just means they're really sick and they can't excrete. Now that could be one answer. The other answer could be there really is no mycotoxin exposure. That's possible. But what I learned from these two patients in the early days was that a lot of people are so sick, they're not excreting in the urine. This is one reason why in some of the tests that we do, we actually pre-treat with either sauna or glutathione to actually push those toxins out and so that we can measure them in the urine. Hello, Mark Andre from Montreal. Question, multiple trauma in childhood and severe psychological stressors that really weakened your body and ended up with systemic lupus at 24. Wow. You always felt your body was under attack and I was under the influence of infections. After digging into functional medicine, you ended up doing DNA PCR testing and found four different kinds of candida. Wow. And opportunistic algae. Oh goodness. So you had lots of fungus, which is real common with autoimmunity, other microbial dysbiosis. Then you developed mast cell activation and deficiencies for C3 and C4, which are related to lupus as well. Do you think that all funguses in my gut, even when they died and used binders could have released a huge amount of mycotoxins and triggered the MCAS? Wow, what a great a synopsis of your history, Marc Andre. Great job, because that gives me all the clues that I need to hopefully give you some information. So first of all, autoimmunity in general is attack of self. And you mentioned psychological trauma stressors. What I've found in many, many people, autoimmune is attack of self, right? And it's a physiological thing where your body does molecular mimicry. It mistakes your self tissue for something that it's trying to fight. Like, for example, you get a bacterial infection, you get yeast in the gut, and your body tries to fight that and create antibodies. But then those antibodies actually cross-react to maybe your thyroid, or maybe your joints in rheumatoid arthritis, or maybe your neurons in multiple sclerosis. So we have this immune system that's trying to protect you, but it gets confused and starts to attack your own tissues. And that leads to autoimmunity. So there's real physiological causes, and I will get to that, I promise. But what I wanted to say, Mark, is bless your heart and thanks for sharing the stresses, because we all have them. We're all human. And what I found in my own journey with autoimmunity is there's pieces that are trauma from childhood or lack of love for ourselves are things that are really important in the healing. It's not the cause. It's not the only thing contributing, but dealing with those childhood patterns and traumas, and even just loving ourselves and appreciating ourselves and not having self-hatred or self-loathing, it kind of parallels the self-attack of the autoimmune, can be really powerful in helping you to heal. But the other question you had is about all these fungal species. Fungus creates all kinds of toxic metabolites, and those can really wreak havoc on the immune system. In fact, I think hidden fungal infections are some of the biggest culprits to Crohn's and colitis and MS and many, many chronic immune issues. And your question was, could that fungus have triggered mast cell activation? Yes, 100%, absolutely. Mold and fungus are huge causes and contributing factors to mast cell activation. Hopefully that answers your question. If you want more details, just shoot me another message, Mark. Sean, thank you for taking the time. You are welcome. Anna, hello. We had your belongings tested at a moldy rental apartment, highly contaminated. So you left everything. First of all, sorry, that is so hard and so common where people have to leave their belongings behind. You moved out in February because you got sick, moved into a brand new building. Unfortunately, you found high levels of penicillin and aspergillus, otherwise passed inspection and air test, saying there's no mold from the landlord. You're pregnant. Wondering if you should leave. This is so hard. I just so understand you guys that when you have mold and you're trying to figure out a safe place to live. So there's a couple options. Not everybody can leave, right? There's either no rentals or your home, you can't sell your home or it's too expensive. So what you can do, you're pregnant. So I would not recommend aggressive detox when you're pregnant. It's just not safe because you're detoxifying and that can go to the baby. Typically, again, you want to check with your OB-GYN. Do not take my word for this, but chlorella, I feel like could be safe in a pregnant or nursing woman. I would not do many other binders. I would not do glutathione. What you can also do is dilution effect with the air. So open your windows, get air filters, whatever you can do there. And it sounds like you got rid of belongings and there might be something like you could fog with a dry fog in the products we love link. On the link that I shared here in the chat, you can find Haven Fog. It's called BioBalance Haven Fog, dry fog. That's what I use in my office and home. And you can actually buy the system and do it yourself. For you being pregnant and for your family, I would stay out for 8 hours and have someone else do the fogging, but it's a citrus safe solution. So it's a very, very botanical kind of safe solution. And then you come back in, so basically you fog with dry fog, and then you have a cleaner or someone that is not sensitive, clean every horizontal surface. It's called small particulate clean. And then you can come back in and you might feel a lot better, even if there's still an ongoing mold source that at least buys you time. It doesn't fix the source, but if you can't move, I would, if you're not pregnant, I would do gentle detox and binders. If you're pregnant, I would open up, get air filtration, get fresh air in the windows, use air filters, like Austin Air is my favorite. And then you could fog, go out of the place, fog it, clean it, and then come back in and you'll probably feel better. And you can find the fog that I like to use in my products we love page, which is, there's a link here in the chat. Hopefully that answered your question. Hi, Darla. I'm just going to do a couple more questions, but we've got lots coming in. Suggestions, please, on how to get rid of heavy metals from the body. Sauna every day and yet showing high levels of multiple types of heavy metals. Well, one thing, Darla, that's important for if you have mold or toxins or chemicals or metals, when you start to detox, you're excreting more. That's a good thing. So if you do a test for urinary mycotoxins or for urinary heavy metals, and you're in the middle of a detox, I would actually expect your levels to rise because you're excreting those out of the body. So you do have to just take those tests with a grain of salt and kind of know where you're at in the process because you want to move it out of your body. And if you're testing the urine, you're typically testing that excretion. So that may not be a bad thing. Some of the best binders for metals would be zeolite and silica. And those are in products like Quicksilver, the binder, Quicksilver binder, and then also my new favorite from Research Nutritionals. I'll put links in for these two. These two are kind of a 1-2 punch. They are Mycopole and Toxipole. So I'm going to pull those up real quick and show you those in links, Mycopole and Toxipole. And again, I would not recommend this pregnant or nursing, but if you are not pregnant or nursing, you could use these together and they're really good for both toxins and mold. And they can be used at the same time. So I'll put those in the chat. Okay, let's see. Darla, that was you. Hi, Judy Ann again. Thank you so much for the nod towards staying on letrozole. Yes, I think that's very wise, even though there's side effects. And thank you for letting me share my story. and yes, I'll be back on Susie Larson probably in April and May. Hi, Misty. Oh, thank you for commenting on my purple hair. Yeah, guys, you know, I decided this year to go a little bit more bright and cheery, bring some joy into life. And so I've got little highlights, purple and yellow. I'm sorry, purple and pink. Duh. So thank you for commenting on that. I've been having fun with it. You might see next time it'll be red. Who knows? I've been changing it every month or two. So thanks for commenting. I've been having fun. Okay, I'm going to do one more question and then we'll sign off for today and I'll be back again soon. Misty, palpitations, Yes, this is something you definitely don't want to ignore. It's super common though with either infections or toxins. I can tell you some heart stabilizing nutrients. I mentioned them before. Coenzyme Q10, 100 to 200 per day. PQQ, 10 to 20 per day. Taurine, 500 twice a day. Carnitine, L-carnitine, 500 twice a day. And magnesium, at least 250 twice a day. Those are kind of some of the core heart nutrients. But you really want to find out what's causing those palpitations. It's sadly common and sadly common either during COVID or post-COVID as well. Okay, thank you all for joining me today. I had so much fun. The time always flies by. I loved your questions. Thanks for your kind words and encouragement. Stop in anytime at jillcarnahan.com. I have new articles every week. Any products that you need, you can go to drjillhealth.com. I didn't mention, but all the mold questions, if you haven't seen the mold detox box, go to molddetoxbox.com. It is an all-in-one. You can see it behind me on the fireplace here. Dr. Jill, this is a basically 30-day everything you need to detox mold. What I did was, obviously, I can see a number of patients, but I can't see everyone who needs help. And so many people are suffering from mold. So if you or someone you love is suffering, this basically gives you the core instructions and everything you need to do basic detox from mold. And granted, it's great if you have a doctor that's helping you, but if you need to get started, that's a great way to start. It's at molddetoxbox.com. You can read and learn more information there. And again, you can kind of start that. If you're sensitive, start at a quarter or half dose. Go very slowly, because like I said before, if you mobilize too quickly and you can't excrete, you get stuck and you don't feel good. I hope you all have a beautiful Easter weekend. Thank you so much for your time and for joining me today. And I will see you all again soon. Bye-bye.